Mamata Banerjee has clearly taken the spotlight in the fight against the BJP, meeting a string of opposition leaders in Delhi today, including Sonia and Rahul Gandhi. The Bengal Chief Minister stood by her comments that the citizens' list in Assam could lead to a civil war and a bloodbath. Amit Shah, meanwhile, announced that he would address a rally in Kolkata next week, setting the stage for a showdown.
2019, BJP will be
finished. An aggressive Mamata Banerjee using the National Register of Citizens to hit out at the government. Across the corridors, the BJP's Amit Shah couldn't speak in the house due to non-stop protest. But the party announced he would go to Kolkata on the 11th to hold a rally.
Kul mila ke Amit Shah ji ko bolne nahi dena, Gruh Mantri ji ko nahi sunna.
Let him go to Bengal 365 days, I don't mind.
Do you think, Didi, that many people are saying that when he said he talked about infiltrators and Didi talked about bloodbath, that is...
No, I am saying that what BJP is doing, that will create the bloodbath. We want peace.
While Mamata Banerjee and Amit Shah toughened their stance on the National Register for Citizens, the day in Parliament was an opportunity for her to reach out to various political parties. Leaving all to wonder, was Mamata Banerjee trying to overshadow the Congress in being the glue to the Mahagathbandhan?
From RJD's Meesa Yadav, Samajwadi's Ram Gopal Yadav and Jaya Bachchan to other crucial blocs like the TDP and YSR who are averse to the Congress, Mamata Banerjee met them all. Ostensibly, it was to invite them for an opposition rally in January, but it was almost as if Mamata's pitch for 2019's PM candidature had begun. The Congress limited to just a supporting role, especially after Rahul Gandhi voicing his support for her recently.
Let the BJP is defeated, then all the political party will sit together and they'll decide.
As Mamata finished her day, it's a clear signal to the other prime ministerial candidates to up their game, from Sharad Pawar to Mayawati, who also met this week.
In Parliament today, where Mamata Banerjee came visiting, she told reporters that she is a simple girl and that if her parents were asked to prove their nationality today, they would perhaps fail. Now, the big question is, will this simple girl pose a challenger to Prime Minister Modi, who also rose to power on the pitch of being a simple chaiwala? At Parliament, with Sunetra Chaudhary, Sonal Mehrotra Kapoor and N. Ravi, Monideepa Banerjee, NDTV.
Well, Arun Jaitley has written another blog today, and here he's attacked Mamata Banerjee, saying that leaders like Rahul Gandhi and Mamata Banerjee must realize that India's sovereignty is not a plaything. Sovereignty and citizenship are the soul of India. Imported vote banks are not. And then he goes on to say that Mamata had stated in 2005 that infiltration in Bengal has become a disaster now, and the Supreme Court had held silent an invidious demographic invasion of Assam may result in the loss of vital districts of Lower Assam. In fact, we went into our archives and found that Mamata Banerjee had indeed raised quite a stink in Parliament on the issue of illegal immigrants into Bengal, as Arun Jaitley pointed out.
They belong to you and us. They belong to global family, they belong to country family, they belong to nation family, they belong to state family, they belong to local family. They have the family members also. They are our family members.
Those pictures earlier of Mamata Banerjee actually tearing up papers on the floor of the house and throwing them at the chair because she was not allowed to raise the issue of illegal immigrants in Bengal back in 2005. Well, lots to talk about tonight. We have joining us Sukhendu Shekhar Roy, Rajya Sabha MP of the Trinamool Congress. Rajat Sethi, political analyst, joining us this evening from Hyderabad. Senior Supreme Court advocate Dushyant Dave is with us. And here in the studio, Pawan Khera of the Congress Party and journalist and author Mr. Nilanjan Mukhopadhyay is with us as well. Mr. Sukhendu Shekhar Roy, can I ask you first that how do you firstly explain Mamata Banerjee's U-turn on the issue of immigrants? She had a position that she held once upon a time when it came to illegal immigrants coming into Bengal. She was so angry about it that she stormed out of Parliament at that time in 2005. Why has she changed her mind on the issue of illegal migrants today?
We are in 2018 and much water has flown into the Ganges or in other rivers of the country. And situation has entirely changed. You see, this government has no respect either for the constitutional provisions like Article 10 and 11 of the Constitution or the provisions of the Citizenship Act, which is based on the principle of just, holy and just recognized. This government has no respect for the Refugee Convention of the United Nations, whereby the member states were directed to protect the human rights of the refugees, and this government should try to distinguish who is refugee and who is infiltrator. This infiltrator and refugee, without distinguishing them, if somebody speaks Bangla or Hindi or Nepali, he should be treated as a foreigner or illegal immigrant. This is a sham. This should be condemnable, and this should be opposed by all nationalist forces, because this country cannot be divided on the basis of religion, on the basis of language, on the basis of region, on the basis of cow or goats.
Mr. Roy, though, can I ask you that does the TMC acknowledge that there is a problem of illegal migrants in Assam? Would you acknowledge that the problem is there and needs to be dealt with?
Any illegal immigrant, if it is found anywhere in India, whether it is in Assam or Jammu Kashmir or in Gujarat, they should be treated in accordance with the law. We have no objection. But when the family members of the first citizen of India, former president of India, are eliminated from the roll, and the husband's name is there, wife's names are not there, this situation arises, then certainly there is a bona fide doubt in the minds of the people as to which way this register has been prepared by the local government.
Okay. Let me ask Rajat Sethi that. Rajat Sethi, is there a problem that's happening here where you have a genuine problem of illegal immigrants that has to be dealt with on one hand, but the way this entire NRC process has rolled out seems to have created a lot of chaos on the ground? In fact, we reported yesterday as well that it's not just a large number of Muslims who are finding their names not in that list, but even in Hindu villages in Assam, you know, there's one predominantly Hindu area which we visited where only 30% of the people found themselves on that list. So it doesn't seem to be, you know, purely a Hindu-Muslim issue. But is there a problem with the way that this has rolled out? And is it problematic when Amit Shah says that those who are not on the list are infiltrators or, you know, guspethe, as he put it? Because then you're immediately assuming that these people who haven't even appealed yet are foreigners and outsiders.
Who will decide who is foreigner?
Niti, first of all, I wanted to address one second.
Go ahead.
So, Mr. Can I please come in?
Yeah.
So, one second. So, I just wanted to address what the representative from TMC wanted to highlight. He said that there's a lot of water that has flowed through the Ganges from 2005 and 2018. I just want to remind him that a lot of votes have flowed into the State Assembly of West Bengal. She clearly knew, Mamata Banerjee clearly knew in 2005 when she was in the opposition, that Bangladeshi illegal migrants were cultivated by the CPM first as a carefully consolidated vote bank. And now over the course of time, it has been used as a formidable vote bank by Mamata ji. So that's exactly what has changed. This is the water that he was talking about. Second, he said that it's the local government which has prepared this clumsy list. First of all, It's as secular a list as it could get. There have been approximately 11.5% population of Assam, which has been left out in the NRC, and then equal percentage, both in Muslims and in Hindu. So it's both 11% in Muslim people missing out from the NRC and an 11% Hindu from the Barak Valley missing out from the NRC register. So it's a purely, perfectly secular thing which has nothing to do with religion. Number one. Number two, you need to understand is that there is a problem. There was always a serious problem. Even in 2005, when the state union, state home minister, Sri Prakash Jaiswal ji, on the floor of the house said that there are 50 lakh illegal migrants as per 2001 data when the census was done. So in the past 2 decades, we all can assume very well that this number would have gone up 60, 70, 80 lakhs. But there is no measure of that. The NRC has been quite lenient, and the measures have been laid out by the Supreme Court in black and white. So it doesn't matter whether you can anecdotally quote the president's family, ex-president's family, or an army officer's family. It's a black and white measure. You provide those documents, be part of those family trees that the NRC has set up these algorithms to measure.
But Mr. Sethi, can I just sorry interrupt you there?
If those things are in place, sure, it will automatically mean that you're part of NRC.
No, but there are two things here. One is that, you know, when the family of the former president of India gets excluded from the list, you know, it's not a black and white issue. This was the president of India, and then we're saying that, oh, now your descendants are not Indian citizens or possibly not Indian citizens, or a former army officer who has served this country and has served the army. Yeah. You know, questions will be raised about why people like this. Or we've seen many examples in the last few days, people from the same family, half the family is in the list, half the family is not in the list. But I am saying that hasn't Amit Shah, by labeling those on the not on the list as infiltrators, then in a sense preempted what the BJP's position on this is going to be? I mean, these people now have to appeal, they have to show their documents to the tribunal, etc. Why label everybody as outsiders already? We don't know how many ultimately will lose their citizenship.
No, first of all, that's what I'm quoting. I'm quoting the government sources tabled on the floor of the house, that these are the number of infiltrators we are dealing with. See, we need to understand that anecdotes cannot brush aside the statistics. Anecdotes cannot gloss over the matter of fact, the seriousness of the facts. We need to see that there were certain set of documents which have been provided. Now, if a person's family, twins or family members, husband, wife, who have not furnished the required number of documents, need to furnish that, and they will be, rendered back into the list. You know, and it's a very, very tedious, complex process. If the second NRC doesn't have their name, then they can go to the claims and objections. Even if that is not true, then go to foreign tribunals, then to the High Court, then to the Supreme Court. So these are all checks and balances in the system in order to be foolproof.
Okay. So okay. So, Pawan, let me take that to the Congress.
The panic button that Mamta ji is doing,
it's alarmist.
Civil wards and blood war.
Yeah. Okay. So you're saying she's being alarmist and she's exaggerating, which I'll ask the TMC about. But Pawan Kheda, anecdotes cannot brush aside hard statistics, is what Rajat Sethi is saying. Can I ask you what I've been trying to understand from the Congress, which is, what is your problem with the NRC? Because it does stem from the Assam Accord that Rajiv Gandhi signed in 1985. The stated aim of that was exactly this. So what is your problem with it today?
Much after Rajiv Gandhi's Assam Accord, Atalji ruled this country for 6 years, 3 months and 13 days. Nothing happened on this. I wonder why. It was Dr. Manmohan Singh who again revived this entire issue. And here we are. There was a lot of litigation. Now we are. This government and the law officer tried to delay it again. Now they are taking credit for whatever they are taking credit for, a faulty list perhaps. But this government's law officer went to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court dismissed his plea and they said, no, this is a deadline. You have to stick to this deadline. Our position on this NRC is the process, is the way it is being done. You may call it anecdotal. The same Sri Prakash Jaiswal the next day said that this is hearsay. These are the numbers I hear. So Mr. Sethi, don't quote from another anecdotal speech of his. Please don't say that. When it comes to data, from between 1991 and 2011, 30,000 immigrants came into Assam. And since Mr. Rajat Sethi's party is always keen on Hindu-Muslim debates, 3,000 of them were Muslims. In this list, a lot of Bihari labor,
sir,
migrant labor,
sorry, you,
sorry, I know you don't
party.
Belong to a party, blah, 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 but forget it. So, migrant laborers, tea estate laborers, they've all been left out of the list. Manoj Tiwari has the guts to say, now we'll do the same in Delhi. Arre, aapse Assam to theek ho nahi raha, Bengal mein bhi chale jayenge NRC lane, Delhi mein bhi chale aayenge NRC lane. Aap kar kya rahe hain? So that's where the apprehension stem from. I absolutely don't agree with what Mamata Banerjee has said today. Don't talk in this language. The situation is very fragile. So as responsible political parties, we need to just ensure that the government addresses our concerns. Rajnath Singh says that this is the first
Congress. The Congress thinks that Mamata is being irresponsible with these statements.
I'll come to that. Rajnath Singh says in the parliament, this is the first list. Don't panic. Amit Shah says, no, nobody in this, who's not in this list. They're all ghuspaithias. Please speak in one language. Manoj Tiwari kuch bol raha hai. Amit Shah kuch aur hi bol rahe hai. Rajnath Singh kuch aur bol raha hai. Bhaiya, chehra kaun hai, mukhota kaun hai, ye bata dijiye. Desh ye janna chahta hai. Don't play politics with this list. Let's all, as responsible political parties, not create panic. Mamata Banerjee perhaps is reacting to these kind of statements. Please ensure that it does not become such a panicky situation. Please ensure that all those northeastern states where you are ruling right now, very proudly so, please ensure that law and order is not a problem there.
So you don't agree, you also believe that Mamata Banerjee is in a sense been alarmist on this? Like you said, you guys don't agree with this language on bloodbath.
One talks in a language which triggers alarm. The other reacts and talks in an alarmist language. That's the problem we are facing. Congress is perhaps the only party which is talking responsibly, which is pointing out at the anomalies. Vice Chancellor, former Vice Chancellor of Assam University is left out. No, these are not anecdotal. Sorry.
Okay, but
I could have agreed with Mr. Sethi ki bhaiya ye anecdotal hai.
Okay,
Amit Shah ko kahiye chup ho jaye phir.
Achha, okay, no. You raised a few important points, and before I take this back to Rajat Sethi and everyone else, Dushyant Dave, just legally speaking, the big question that we've been trying to determine now is what happens to these people. And you know, India doesn't seem to really have a plan on what to do when people actually do become stateless. What's going to happen when these 4 million people end up, if it's still 4 million at the end of it, what are we going to do with them? Mr. Dave.
Let me, before I answer that question, Nidhi, let me say one thing. That this debate is not political, and this debate certainly should not be made religious. This debate is about law, and the law is that who has a right to be a citizen of India. Constitution defines that, and those who are not citizens of India have no right to be in India. That's very clear. So question is that, you know, the Section 6A of the Citizenship Act, which was brought into force after 1985 accord by late Rajiv Gandhi, that has expressly recognized two things, which is very curious and which is where, you know, both BJP and the opposition really must concentrate, that persons of Indian origin in the undivided India who came into Assam prior to 1966 have automatic right to become citizens. That's one. Those who came between 1966 to 1971 had a right for 10 years to be citizens without voting rights, but after that they can register and even have right to vote. So all those people who came up to 1971 really have a right to be in India. They are treated as citizens of India by virtue of this provision, which the Supreme Court has itself said in this 2015 judgment of Justices Gogoi and Justice Nariman, that they proceed on the basis that this provision is legal and valid, although the challenge to that has been referred to the Constitution bench. Now, question is that having held that, the Supreme Court said that there is provision for determining whether there are illegal immigrants in this country or not. There is a tribunal which is constituted under law, and that tribunal should be directed to determine whether a person is citizen or not. Now, what really is a problem, and that's where I think political parties should show little bit of a restraint in, you know, not politicizing this, is that in a country like India, it is very, very difficult to expect the administration to be absolutely correct. There are issues of inefficiency, there are issues of corruption, there are issues of bias, and there are issues of downright negligence. Now, these are the issues which are plaguing the exercise which has been carried out.
I think that's
out.
An important
and that
point.
That is why you find that large number of people who should not be in the list have been included.
No,
those who are
exactly
excluded,
you make an important
really
point, but Mr. Dave, you said
so
this shouldn't be a political
really
issue,
a
that this is actually a matter of law. But Nilanjan Mukhopadhyay, everything is a political issue, yes, especially in the run up to the next election. Therefore, can I ask you politically, the fact that Mamata has placed herself front and center of this battle, and now we're hearing some discordant notes with the Congress saying that she's perhaps being a little alarmist in her language. What does this also mean in terms of how this is playing out politically for the opposition?
Well, explaining Mamata's position, she's obviously playing to the gallery because she has a certain vote bank in Bengal, the minorities, and she's essentially trying to,
address them.
Take a position, we know, which takes a position in support of them. So let's not really, you know, it is a fairly alarming thing. This is not actually a civil war situation. My problem with this entire discourse, you know, as Dushyant Dave was saying, that everything is a matter of law, but nothing is a matter of law as far as the discourse is concerned in politics. Everything is a matter of politics. Politics has been played over the fact that it was Rajiv Gandhi who signed the accord. Now, if you actually go back and read the editorials of that particular time, very senior editors of the period, there was no television journalism in India at that point. had said, you know, that there was a certain amount of populist pressure which weighed on the government, especially Rajiv Gandhi, who was in a tearing hurry to sign one accord after another accord. You know, there was a Mizo accord, there was the Assam accord, there was a Punjab accord, you know. So it was actually a man in a hurry trying to prove that I'm trying to out here resolve issues. So, you know, history and especially decisions taken in history should not be a fait accompli for us in contemporary India. We should always have the courage to say that all of us simultaneously should go back and relocate. Now, what is happening is that there is a second NRC which has come. My problem is with the political dichotomy which is there in the BJP. You have two clear streams. One is the executive stream represented by Rajnath Singh and the Assam Chief Minister, and the other is Mr. Amit Shah and the other people like Manoj Tiwari, their Tapan Ghosh in West Bengal, who start immediately converting it into a poll propaganda issue. You know, the issue goes back, right? You know, it becomes a religious issue. Let's also try to understand, when the Assam agitation was at the peak, it was the RSS which brought in a religious component very strongly by Balasaheb Devras. He was a Sarsang Chalak. He said that you have to distinguish between Hindu refugees and Muslim infiltrators. Since then, this has been the dominant way in which
is in a way reflected by the Citizenship Amendment Bill also, which will give Hindu migrants from neighboring countries.
You know, if you read that, you'll find that that's exactly the speech which Balasaheb Devras made in one of the RSS gatherings.